One of the biggest problems these days is dog training is so segregated and segmented that there's very little unity among people within the same profession. And there's not even a unified certification that's generally accepted. And there are people who have become so dug into their particular philosophy or how their trainer taught them that they become closed-minded and they don't keep themselves open to new things, new possibilities, the way things can be just done a little bit better.
But a misconception can be made that the dog has issues that cannot be fixed because somebody works with only one method. A good trainer, in my book, knows many methods because there's more than one breed, there's more than one condition, there's more than one behavior. So one method does not always work. And if you're gonna stick with, say, the clicker, or, you know, no, it's just not gonna work on some animals, and that animal can find itself in a shelter, it could find itself in a rescue situation, or it could find itself with a needle.
When you have dogs that are bred, or you have an animal that's bred for a certain purpose, if you remove them from that purpose, you get dogs that are frustrated.
Don't let them, okay.
You get dogs that aren't doing what they're supposed to do, so automatically they're going to act out and try to get back to what their original intent was. As you bring them into the family unit, people like different aesthetics in their dogs, they like different appearances. They don't necessarily think about the job.
Us will ever know what is in the heart of a dog.
People look at a border collie or a Lassie and go, oh, we saw Timmy and he saved Timmy and I want a Lassie, it's so beautiful. And they don't take into account this is a working dog. Their intelligence was bred into them so that they could be out on the farm and not be told every second of the day what to do.
The intelligence of some collies is almost unbelievable. And yet every day, such dogs all over the country are helping their masters protect their flocks.
So when you have an independent breed who has a job, you have to remember it's going to want to do something. It can't sit around and not do anything. So a lot of the behavior issues that come apart from these dogs being brought in because of how they look instead of what they're meant to do is that you're trying to make a pumpkin into a peanut.
Once you start to bring them away from their original purpose, you have to put a lot more training into the dog in order to get them to settle down. Through training, you're trying to lower the dog's natural drives for that job, and you're trying to kill that drive in order to make it a family pet.
What we're gonna do before we go up and see the wolves is we are going to let the wolves know that we are coming.
This is when we act goofy and we start howling.
All right, ready? One, two, three.
Originally, people studied wolves to get a good history and get a good idea on the wolf pack and the dynamics within that to understand how the pack operates, and they took that and applied it to the domesticated dog.
Kind of get back to the dog thing. Here in captivity, alpha actually does hold a true meaning.
It's a good idea to understand where dogs came from. It's a good idea to understand pack dynamics, so to speak. It's a good idea to understand how wolf society works.
Although it's very important to understand where they came from and that some of the things still apply, to base an entire training philosophy off of two essentially separate breeds that are so different from each other, in today's science, it's faulty.
A dog has been domesticated over thousands of years to really be in touch and really be in tune with their human family member, their human component. And because of that, the domesticated dog is very good at reading our facial expressions, reading our behavior, reading our gestures, reading our tones of voice. The wolf isn't. Wolves, for example, don't respond to praise. They don't really respond to food reinforcement the way a dog does. Whereas a domestic dog, even a dog that has never met a human, will seek out human affection and human attention. The wolf does not. The dog takes cues from the human as to how to problem solve things, and the wolf does not.
In the 1900s is when we really started getting more of the profession of dog training. Originally, dog training was just, it was either harsh methods for war dogs. The dogs were raised and brought up and bred if they could do a particular job. They didn't care if they were pretty. Did the dog work? Could the dog do what it needed to do? And if that's the case, then keep the dog, breed the dog. If not, the dog went bye-bye.
Now, it's more about, let's try not to be abusive. I think more as the light of abuse came in. Same way with children. Spare the rod, spoil the child. Spare the rod, spoil the dog. There's still people who think that you can train your dog by a rolled up newspaper. That just the sight of the rolled up newspaper will have it do anything. And a lot of times, you know, will it stop the behavior it's doing? Yes, but not because it wants to stop the behavior, and they're not giving the dog another behavior, so it's not training. Training is saying, that's wrong, this is what I want you to do. So instead of doing this, do this, and getting the dog to do this. There's been a lot of harsh reprimand right up until about like the 70s and 80s when people realized that you didn't need to be so harsh, that we were actually creating worse behavior by having the dog fear peeing, fear aggression, fear. It's a fight or flight animal. So when science stepped in and said, hey, wait a second, we can get the same response by training the dog that if you do this, you're going to get a positive reward. And we got it a little bit faster and without the other negative behaviors.
Some advances in technology allow us to do things a little differently, but nothing's really new. It's just improved a little bit through time and through technology.
The fact of the matter is both methods work, but they don't work apart from each other. They don't work in a vacuum. What really needs to happen is you need to have a marriage of both. You need to be able to get the dog and motivate the dog to do what you want, but you need to be able to tell the dog, don't do this, do that instead. And if you're using positive only, then that can't happen. Both methods are very, very limited in and of themselves when you marry them together. You can use them both appropriately and judiciously without overusing one or the other. If you overuse one or the other, then there's an imbalance in the dog and you have a breakdown in your training.
When we spend years and years trying to get a dog to be a certain way, whether it be a hunting dog or a working dog, a guard dog, or just a companion, it's very hard to take all that brain in here and twist it and say, well, now we just want you to sit on the end of a couch and interact with us how we want, although we're not going to show you what we want, we're just going to expect you to know it. You have to remember that each animal needs a specific way to get the most out of it. If you forget that each animal has individual needs, because there may be another Chihuahua that's a little bit more stable than, say, Lulu here. Lulu's a little bit more nervous. So she wants that quiet reassurance that she's doing the right thing in order to get the most out of her. Whereas someone like Molly is a little bit more high energy, you may have to give her a little bit more of a redirection. If you were gentle with her, she'd just go, well, you don't mean it, so I'm gonna do what I want. Whereas Lulu just kind of turns into glue. Right, Lulu?